Remember when I had my all-in-one installed? My AC coupled inverter and 8.2 kilowatt hour battery were ripped out and left on the garage floor. Well, I was planning to sell it on, but then I decided that might be a lot of hassle and I could really do with that extra storage. So I wired it all back up again. Right, I'm gonna start by saying do not try this at home. I am a professional idiot, but if for some reason you do decide to have a go at this, I need to be clear that what I'm about to show you is currently an unsupported configuration. You can't just call up GivEnergy and complain that it's not working properly. But with that disclaimer out of the way, here it is then in all its glory. I've tried to make it as neat and tidy as possible, adding some trunking to hide a lot of the cables. We've got a new mini consumer unit just for the additional circuit that's been put in for it, and that also houses the power meter. Now the problem is that the all-in-one and the AC coupled inverter, which I'll refer to as the AC3, are not designed to work together. If you leave them to it, they will just start cross-charging. One will start pushing power out, the other will think there's excess to use to charge, and it slowly escalates until they're pumping power across at full pelt. So you need something to keep an eye on that. You also probably want them to stay reasonably balanced in terms of their state of charge, so they get used equally as much and one battery doesn't wear out more than the other one. To do that, you need something else. GivEnergy are working on something called an EMS, or Energy Management System, and that will be a little box that controls your inverters for you. If you have an all-in-one, then you already have an EMS hidden inside the gateway, but it's not active yet. So in the meantime, I'm using Home Assistant. I'm not going to go into too much detail about Home Assistant here or how to set it up. I'll just say that it's a home automation product that you usually run on dedicated hardware like a Raspberry Pi. There are loads of guides out there on how to set this up, including other videos on my channel, so I'll put some links in the description for you. There are a few solutions that people have created for balancing GivEnergy inverters, but my solution is actually based on an automation created by Paul from GivEnergy in his spare time. He actually has the same setup as me and gave me a lot of advice and information to help me get this up and running, so thank you Paul, you are a credit to your company. I've tweaked his automation quite a bit to meet my needs and also to make it easier for anyone to configure, but it does require things to be wired up in a very specific way. Here's my wiring diagram for the all-in-one. You can see that the grid feed comes into the gateway and the all-in-one hangs off the gateway, which is pretty standard. My solar inverter also hangs off the gateway, which is quite important for it to be able to monitor your solar generation. My EV charger is wired into the gateway too and is connected into the grid side but monitored so as it's not seen as load. Finally, my house load is connected off the gateway too. This is all standard stuff for an all-in-one setup. I've had an extra circuit run from my consumer unit on its own MCB, so it's not protected by the existing RCBOs or RCDs. That runs to a new little consumer unit with its own RCD in. Also in there are MCBs for the AC3 and the EM115 energy monitor. The EM115 CT clamp is placed around the live grid feed going into the gateway and hidden nicely within some trunking. So as you can see here, the AC3 is actually on the load side of the gateway, which means that the all-in-one will see the AC3 as load. Once you have it wired up, you'll need to set up Home Assistant. Assuming you already have Home Assistant running, you'll need the GiveTCP add-on running so as it can communicate with both of your inverters. There are videos on my channel on how to set up GiveTCP and I'll put a link to the latest version of that video in the description for you. When you've got it installed, find the IP addresses for your inverters. And yes, there's another video on my channel to show you how to find those. And configure your all-in-one as inverter 1 and the AC3 as inverter 2. Make sure you tell GivTCP you have two inverters, the all-in-one has zero batteries, and you tell GivTCP that it is an all-in-one too, just like in this screenshot. Also, make sure that you set the self-run loop timer to 10 seconds. The automation I'm about to show you is expecting data to be updated every 10 seconds. Before we install the automation, we need to create a toggle helper, which is like a virtual switch, to keep track of whether balancing is running or not. This switch will be turned on and off by the automation and prevents it from running multiple times simultaneously. Navigate down to Settings, Devices and Services, and then choose Helpers up in the top right and the blue Create Helper button in the bottom right. Scroll down to find Toggle, which is just there, and give it a name. In this case, it's going to be called GivEnergy Balancer Running, and click on Create. If you are using the Intelligent Octopus Go tariff to charge your car, the one that gives you extra dynamic hours outside of your fixed off-peak hours, then you'll want to install the HA Octopus Intelligent from MegaKid integration via Hacks. I have another video about Hacks, so I'll put a link to that and the integration you need in the description. That integration will give you a sensor called Octopus Intelligent Slot, which will be on when there's an active Octopus Intelligent slot. If you don't use Intelligent Octopus tariff, then you can create a dummy toggle helper called Dummy Octopus Intelligent Slot or something, using the same steps from when you created the balancer running toggle, and then turn it off and leave it off. This automation will also assume that you have an EV charger and that you have a sensor that can read the power of the charger in watts, not kilowatts. If you don't have an EV charger or any way to read the power from it, then you'll need to create a dummy power sensor. Back in the helpers page, click on Create Helper and we want to choose a type of template. We're going to choose a normal template a sensor option there, not a binary sensor, and we're going to give it a name. In this case, we're going to call it Dummy EV Power. Now the state template is going to be two curly brackets, a space, a zero, another space, and then two closed curly brackets. Unit of measurement is going to be, it's going to be W, which a capital W for watts. The device class is going to be power, and the state class is measurement. Okay, we're going to click on submit and that will create a power sensor that will always read as 0 watts. Okay, we're ready to finally install the automation. I've tried to make this process as easy as possible, so I've turned it into a blueprint and placed it on GitHub. You can either visit my website and look at the article that goes with this video. On there, you'll find a button that you can click on that should automatically install it for you. Or if you want to do it manually, then in Home Assistant, go down to Settings, Automations and Scenes, and Blueprints up at the top. You can import a blueprint and paste in the URL of the blueprint itself on GitHub. Click on Preview and then Import Blueprint. Once you have the blueprint installed, it's time to create an automation from it. Navigate down to Settings, Automations and Scenes, and click on Create Automation. You should see the blueprint appear in the Create Automation list, so click on that there. Now this should be quite self-explanatory, but you need to choose the stator charge entity for your all-in-one, and that one's that for me. Then you need to choose your AC3 stator charge entity, which is that one for me. EV charger power, now I've got the dummy one created, and then the balancer running toggle helper, which is the one we first created, and then your Octopus Intelligent slot active one, which for me here is a dummy one that we created as well. And then at first you should leave these cross charge threshold values as they are, but I'm going to tweak my all-in-one to AC3 threshold down to 50, just because I know that works a little bit better for me in my situation. But you start with the defaults and work out what's best for you. And click on save. Gonna give it a name and save again. And that's it. It'll be running in the background, checking for cross-charging and pausing an inverter briefly in order to shift the load to the other inverter, and also checking to make sure that the inverters are keeping in step with each other in terms of their charge level, and again pausing one of the inverters temporarily until the other one catches up. But of course, you want to be able to see what is going on. There are several sensors that you should keep your eyes on. I have an entities card showing several useful entities, and you can watch the switches toggle by themselves as balancing kicks in and see the various power values in real time. I'll put a template configuration for that card up on my website so as you can see the entities I've used, but what I really like to use to keep an eye on things is a gauge card. It's a specially created bodge of a few components all merged together to show the power output of both batteries, their state of charge, whether or not they've been paused, and whether or not the balancer is running. If you'd like to recreate this yourself, you'll need to add a few components to Hacks first. They're all front-end components. You'll need stacking card, mushroom cards, and card mod, and I'll put links to all of those in the video description. Then go over to my website, which I'll put a link to in the description, and grab the gauge card configuration. Copy it to your clipboard and then come back here. Over in Home Assistant, you'll need to edit your dashboard and click on Add Card. Scroll all the way down to the bottom and choose Manual, then delete whatever's there and paste in my configuration over the top. Now you'll need to make sure you edit the entity IDs to match your actual entity IDs, so you've got them for the individual SOC, eco and balance switches and sensors. So you can see 1, 2, 3, and then there'll also be one for the gauge itself, which is up here, and then you have to repeat that for the other gauge as well. Save that and you should have a nice little gauge on your dashboard. Now, if you can tear yourself away from watching the gauges moving on your dashboard, there's one more thing that I want to mention. The two inverters combined will import at 9 kilowatts. You'll probably want to schedule both inverters to charge at the same time during your off-peak hours, and you do that using the GivEnergy portal. You can't use the GivEnergy app, at least not at the moment, because this just isn't exactly a supported configuration, but you can manage each inverter separately in the portal. If you're doing other things during those off-peak hours, such as charging your car, heating your hot water, running your washing machine, etc., I suggest you lower the charge power on the all-in-one from 6 kilowatts just to be safe. I have mine set to 3.5 kilowatts because at that speed, I can still easily charge the 13.5 kilowatt hour battery to full during my 4 hours of off-peak energy. Anyway, if you do use the blueprint, then keep your eyes on the GitHub page or my website, because I'll update it if I discover any bugs or if I figure out any improvements. Please give this video a like and don't forget to subscribe to my channel to see more from me. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.